Hoffman's ballet, The Nutcracker and the Mouse King, or book, The Nutcracker and the Mouse King, is a really fascinating story. And once I started researching Nutcracker, which is an odd thing to say after I've danced it for about 40 years myself, I actually found out that the ballet is actually, a lot of the ballet is based off the rewrite that Alexander Dumas did of Hoffman's original book. And then my understanding is that Tchaikovsky then wrote the music to go along with the story that Alexander Dumas had rewritten after Hoffman did the book. So I think it's a couple of things. It's become a timeless tradition in America where it's not so much about the ballet, but about it's almost become a part of American culture, and its biggest success originally, or when it was done, was in America. Once they started doing it, it became part of that Christmas experience where you would go to the Nutcracker as part of the Christmas celebration. So the original story is actually very dark, and a lot of it is actually not in the ballet. And that's probably what intrigued me about doing the ballet, is some of that imagery that was in the original book by Hoffman. So that was a jumping off point for me when we were trying to reimagine what Nutcracker would look like if it was done today. So I went back and read the book several times, and I got more seduced by the book, and trying to reconceive it in a way that would be appealing to a new generation of ballet goers. The protagonist Marie in this particular production is a headstrong young woman that's grown up in growing up in a very strict sort of bourgeois German strong family. The name Starbarn, which is the name of the family in the original book, is means steel tree. So it's a very strong family. So I read a really interesting essay that took the Nutcracker from Marie's perspective, and about how Hoffman's idea was actually to have this character, Drosselmeyer, open up Marie's imagination to what else there was in the world, rather than this very strict, rigorous upbringing that she was having. So for me, Marie's, essentially adventure through this whole ballet is to open up her imagination. So that was a jumping off point. Once I decided that's how I wanted to approach the ballet, then it was just a matter of trying to make the two acts of music that Tchaikovsky wrote make sense and make that a very linear story, which I think in most of the productions I've seen, and I'm not saying all of them, but I've always felt like the ballets have been two, or the Nutcracker has been two separate ballets. There's Act One and then there's Act Two, where it doesn't feel like there's a strong connection to the first act. So if you come to the ballet, or if you're watching this now, you're at the ballet, you will see how I've tried to connect the two acts together and then try and show it through Marie's eyes, or explain the story through Marie's eyes. And Drosselmeyer is a huge part of that. So Marie has a more active role in Act Two than sitting there and enjoying what looks like a performance that's very sort of outwardly audience orientated. So again, it still goes back to this idea of everything that's happening is happening in Marie's imagination. So to do that, all the divertissements that you see in the second act are actually characters that were at the Christmas party in the first act. So when Marie travels through time or through space or whatever this is into this new reality, it's this idea that, well, wait a minute, you were just at the party that I had. So it gives us that idea of, well, is this a dream? Is it real? Is this really happening to Marie? So we play along those lines a little bit. So you will see her be an active participant in some of those divertissements as well. She won't just be sitting there. She will be helping make these divertissements or come to life with the help of Drosselmeyer. So hopefully she's not as passive as perhaps you may be familiar with in other productions. I've heard that there's a similarity between the story of the Wizard of Oz and this, and I think that's quite valid in that all the characters who came to the Christmas party in the first act, we then see reappear in the second act in some capacity. So in that sense, I think it's very much like that idea of the Wizard of Oz. But I also tend to think it's a little bit like Where the Wild Things Are, where that young boy goes on that amazing adventure, but the whole thing happens in his own bedroom, right? So I feel like through the talents and the extraordinary set design that we've been given by Thaddeus Strasburger, we've created this place that is one room, which creates a myriad of problems for ballet, actually, which is kind of interesting to talk about as well. But the whole ballet takes place in one room in a German embassy. So from that context, is it real or is it not real? Is it all Marie's imagination or not? And we have some amazing technology to make all of this happen. We're using 5 different projectors to help us change the space instantaneously. And then we've got Drosselmeyer, who's essentially in control of all of this and really trying to open Marie's eyes up to what's out in the world and what's possible if you use your imagination. With regard to Drosselmeyer's character, I have made a rather significant change, and it has no relation to the book. It has no relation to the story, other than my own personal feelings that if Marie was going to have someone that was going to be a role model or open up her imagination, I just feel like a young girl would be more open to getting that information from a woman, and it would be a more relatable relationship. This idea that Drosselmeyer comes back into the house in the middle of the night and takes Marie away from her family is an odd one for me to swallow. So I just thought this strong female character. And the other thing about the Drosselmeyer in this particular production, we actually don't know if she is real or not, I think. Is she an actual visceral person, or is she some sort of fantastical creature? And we could go either way on that. That's open to interpretation from the audience. But I just felt like a young, impressionable girl should have a strong female role model. So in the original book, E.T.A. Hoffman's book, Marie has an older sister, Louisa, who's quite prominent in the book. And I wanted to reintroduce her into this version. So as another way of connecting, I created my own backstory. So again, I've used the book I thought I was going to stay very true to the book. And as my mind got going, I found all these little avenues that I could explore that were might be a good jumping off point. So in that sense, the book has become sort of a jumping off point for the greater good of this ballet. So Marie has an older sister called Louisa, and I wanted to introduce her in the first act. I wasn't quite sure how. And then I thought, well, perhaps Louisa could be off at French boarding school. And by doing that, I could create roles for our majors in the university that were slightly older, more adolescent children in the party scene, which opened me up to technically more flexibility with regard to the steps I could do, because they're a higher caliber dancer than the very young ones. So that excited me. So there was a possibility of more intricate choreography. By bringing Louisa in the first act, she's gifted a panpipe for Christmas. And then her 4 girlfriends from this French boarding school that she's away at also join the Christmas party. So then and they all get panpipes. So then when we see them next in Act 2, they're essentially still, they come to the party in their school uniforms, and then we do a version of their school uniform when we see them dance the divertissement of the marzipan, or Merlotons. And they're the same characters that we've seen in Act 1, and Marie is somewhat reunited with her older sister. So that's one of the ways that we did that. A helicopter view of my creative process is Yeah, it's sort of all over the shop, really. I've listened to the music ad nauseum, and not I've listened to the music ad nauseum intentionally, which is something I wouldn't do during the year because we're so used to hearing it for 3 months every year, and I've been doing that for such a long time. But I have to say, often I've gotten to the point in my choreography where I can walk into a room full of dancers and have no pre-prepared steps. And that might drive some people crazy a little bit, but I love the idea of this collaborative process with the artists slash dancers and the music and what steps come out of me. I think we all hear music differently. I think you could listen to Tchaikovsky and I could listen to Tchaikovsky, and just because of our biological makeup, we just hear different intonations and sounds and frequencies. And I just have to trust that process, I think, more than anything. I do tend to over choreograph and put too many steps in, so that's a jumping off point where I will probably over choreograph it and then I have to edit it down. But I'm very interested in pushing the classical technique as much as I can, in a non-traditional way, but still have it look like ballet, that is still relatable to the ballet goer or the regular ballet person that comes to the ballet. I tend to use a lot of upper body port-de-bras and steps that may be contemporary in a sense, but still in pointe shoes and still fit within that classical vernacular. It's a little bit hard to describe. So I think that's the main thing. I mean, the whole process has to start with the libretto, right? So I wrote out the libretto, and then I had to decide how to link everything, and then how am I going to say what I want to say through movement? So, and then you have your collaborators, and we have some incredible collaborators on this project. And then you get their input, and then that will spark another idea. So, to say I conceived and choreographed it may be true in a sense, but it's a tremendous amount of collaboration that brings something like this together. So when I'm choreographing a piece like this in a collegiate atmosphere, I for the college students or the majors that are part of our program here at Indiana University, I do not dumb it down. I do not make it any easier than I would if I was working with a professional company. I feel like that's the way you get growth and improvement out of the artist. So my way of choreographing it is to choreograph the steps that I think will tell the story. And if the steps are technically incredibly hard, so be it. Now, if they attempt the steps for 3 weeks of rehearsal, day in, day out, and they're still having difficulty with it, then I don't want them to go on stage worried and feeling like it's a 50-50 chance of success, right? Because that doesn't help propel the story. So then only after that will I make changes, and not to say make it easier, but perhaps just make it a little bit more fluid or less technical, while still trying to say or convey what we want with the movement. So there is no difference in choreographing this here on these students and, a major ballet company. I don't think I would do it any differently. Nutcracker, the ballet, has been put under the microscope a little bit. I think that's fair to say. With regard to cultural appropriation, and I don't think that has been an unfair way to look at the ballet, and I think creating a new ballet, you have to be fundamentally aware of what can and is maybe offensive to different audience members and different cultures. There are certainly things that we can easily take care of that are just offensive, because they're not even appropriate within the countries that they've been contextualized from. So from that perspective, that's easy. Now it gets more technical. It's a bigger conversation, I think, because we're also looking at these. If you want to make real change, then you would probably rewrite the music and everything from the ground up. Well, then is it still Nutcracker the ballet that we've come to know? So, it's a real balancing act, right? So a lot of this we're looking through the lens of Tchaikovsky's eyes and his interpretation through the music. Have we done a perfect job of it? Probably not. Does that mean we're going to stop working on it? No, we'll keep working and keep trying to improve it. The nice thing about a ballet like Nutcracker is you have that opportunity to keep fine-tuning it year after year after year. Now, my interpretation, I can go to a country and be a visitor, or I've lived abroad in many different countries, and my interpretation of the cultural aspects of that country may be very different from someone else that's had the same experience. So there's a broad swath of how we present those ideas and our own ideas of what our experience in a certain country may or may not have been. So we've done our best to not be disrespectful of anything. But again, it will be ongoing. I think the score is a historical masterpiece. So, if that's your jumping off point, then there has to be a little bit of latitude, I think. But I think the fact that everyone is having these conversations is a great start.